Hey kids, you wanna get hammered? Hey, at least I didn't make the lame old hammer time joke. But guess what? You will never be as cool as MC Hammer. What this has to do with the video? Nothing. I just said it because I can. This is about blunts. No, not joints, you frickin' potheads. Blunt weapons. Maces, hammers, clubs. You know, a tree branch, what have you. Might come in handy for writers or game masters in various RPGs or whatever, game developers. Nerds on their couch eating Doritos. Yes, I'm in a weird mood today, deal with it. So I want to talk about pros and cons of these weapons. I've talked about that compared to swords before. That was really about swords versus axes and blunt weapons. Some of that applies, but I wanted to talk specifically about this. This was also a request. So first pro, can be cheap. That's a big can, because if you're generalizing all blunt weapons, you have so much. You have literally just a tree branch, a club, very simple. In fact, some wooden clubs are not simple at all. There are some beautiful examples from Oceania, which are intricately carved and have a lot of interesting shapes. Some are almost sword-like. And so you can have a lot of artistic complexity in that, or you can have a very simple club, sometimes studded with something, iron or scrap or what have you. But you can also have a mace made for a king, literally. So there's a wide variety. Some are not cheap at all and not supposed to be, but they can be. You know, if you look at something like early medieval maces, they are pretty simple and wouldn't be all that costly to make. The head can be made of bronze, brass, even copper in some cases, really just some metal. It doesn't matter even if it's soft, it doesn't need to hold an edge. If it deforms a bit on impact, it's not that big of a deal. So there are some good options there that would be perfectly affordable, yet still effective. Second, they require little maintenance. You know, if you look at something like this, Warhammer, I mean, yeah, you should oil the steel every now and then. It's not that big of a deal if you don't, really. This one I did allow to age naturally, and I think it looks quite nice. There are, you know, there's some damage to the haft, so sometimes you have to replace the wooden haft if it has one. If it doesn't, if it's an all steel construction, like a lot of flanged maces are all steel, there's not a whole lot that can go wrong. Even if there is damage, particularly to an all steel mace or warhammer, it's going to be pretty minor. It's going to be cosmetic. It's not really going to affect the function much. Like this one, for example, if you look at the tip of the beak here, it's a little bit bent and, you know, slightly flattened there. It's really not a big issue. You can just continue using it. Edge damage on blades is much more significant and can affect the usage quite a bit. The third pro is that they're pretty easy to use. Especially if you think of something like a Neolithic club. There is not, I mean, we don't know if they had a martial arts system. There's no way to know. There's no writing from that time. Either way, it's not that complicated. Especially if you have something like this. This is an aluminum hand bow. You know, some sort of stick can be pretty effective, and you don't really need to know that much. Yes, there are stick fighting techniques. But as long as you're halfway decent at swinging it, actually put your body weight into it and use the momentum, it's not that complicated because you don't have to worry about edge alignment. There is no edge. I mean, with some weapons, like the Warhammer, there is a bit of alignment to worry about. Like if you if you're trying to strike something and you hit it, you know, kind of like this, a little bit off. In this case, again, there's spikes, so they will still catch the target. So even if it's off, it's still going to hit pretty hard. But there is going to be a difference between hitting flat on like this or hitting with the corner. That also depends on what you're trying to accomplish. This is better for penetrating into targets and denting armor, for example. This would be better for knocking the head around in a helmet. And that leads me to the next point. They're effective against armor, obviously. Even if you're dealing with plate armor, you know, striking a plate, it can dent it and restrict movement of the wearer, or it can also, just through sheer concussive force, break bones underneath if it's a particularly powerful blow, especially against what you would consider medium armor, mail, for example. Mail is not going to protect against this pretty much at all. This will, just with a sheer concussive force, will just drive straight through the mail and still break bone underneath. So that's very effective. And again, even against the best sort of armor you could afford, the head is going to be a good target. Because even with a really good helmet, if you strike the helmet from the side, for example, and hits it and knocks the head around, that's prime concussion time. Because this, the head being quickly accelerated, stretches the brain tissue, which causes knockouts and brain damage, things like that. So even if you don't manage to penetrate the helmet, this would still be pretty devastating to the user, and it would likely incapacitate them if you manage to get a good hit on the helmet. Now, of course, helmet being spherical are pretty good at deflecting blows instead of, you know, just absorbing all that force head on, if you will. But that's where this comes in. You know, the spike can actually make an indent into the surface, and instead of glancing off, it can kind of dig in and really transfer more of that force to the helmet without glancing. And finally, they hit hard, especially for the weight. This Warhammer weighs only about 800 grams or even less. I think it was like 790 something, which is really light. It's lighter than a lot of swords, but because the mass distribution is the exact opposite of a sword, and a sword would be like this basically, have most of the mass in the hilt, so this is nice and quick and all that, but this is powerful because it's got all the mass at the end, so the lever really generates a lot of force whenever you're striking with it. Whatever you hit is going to have a bad day or be damaged in case of armor. That also means that they're not easy to parry. If you try to stop like a full force hammer or mace swing, you have to really brace yourself. If you swung this hammer at me and I try to parry it like this or like this, that's not happening at all. I would have to, you know, do like a half sword block like this and really meet it as early as possible, or I would have to move offline and redirect the force because you just can't take it directly on the sword. It's just not enough mass here compared to the hammer. All right, on to the cons. First one, they're not as nimble as swords in particular. For the reasons I already pointed out, the mass distribution is different, so it takes you a lot more effort to accelerate and especially decelerate and stop it. That can be mitigated by keeping it moving. You have to use different techniques compared to a sword. With a sword, you can cut like this and keep threatening the opponent at all times. It's very controllable. I mean, most types of sword, not all of them, are controllable the same way. This, I mean, yes, you can. I can stop it like this, but it takes me a lot more effort. It takes a lot more energy. And if I don't do it right, in fact, if I put too much force into it and then try to stop it here, I might overextend the wrist and hurt myself. Again, I made another video about that topic in particular. So I do need to generally keep it moving because that allows me to keep using that momentum so I don't have to stop it. I can just keep going, which means that's a somewhat more predictable movement pattern. Now, there are exceptions, of course. This stick here is pretty light, and yes, you can strike with it quickly and raise up to guard, do stop it, redirect it, do whatever you have to. And the same goes for a lot of indigenous club designs. A lot of them are quite light and fast, but the general tendency is that blunt weapons tend to be a little bit forward heavy. They have to be effective, because if you make them lighter or bring the balance lower, then they're just not going to hit as hard, which is their primary way of being effective. I've seen that a number of times in zombie head tests with a sword or an axe especially. The edge concentrates a lot of that force on a very small surface area. Or, you know, spikes. Now that's of course where this comes in. But if you have just a fairly large impact area, it takes a lot of extra force to really do much damage. And they usually don't have hand protection. I say usually because there are some examples that typically have a disc guard attached to them. So that can be useful. Another potential disadvantage is the reach. If we compare this Messer here, which is not particularly long for a single-handed sword, you can see that it is quite a bit longer. Now, it also depends on where you grip it, of course. You know, you grip it, if we compare where to grip it, so I would grip the hammer about here, which is the same as with the sword. I can get a little bit of extra reach by gripping it lower, but again, that comes at the cost of it being less maneuverable. So usually you have a little bit less reach compared to a sword. That applies to single-handed blunt weapons. Pole hammers, for example, have plenty of reach, obviously. I don't have one here right now, although I did a test with a pole hammer a while ago. I say a while, it must be like 2 or 3 years ago by now, probably three. Anyway, what I have right now is this two-handed mace from Kalamazoo. This is a LARP weapon, and I actually got this originally because I was planning to do a fight choreography with a friend of mine, and they were kind enough to send this to me for free. I was just asking if I can borrow this along with a large two-handed sword. Unfortunately, that hasn't worked out yet because shortly after I got this, you know, the pandemic happened, lockdowns, then we had to move out of the house back into an apartment. Now I don't have a good location, etc., etc. So I'm still hoping to be able to do something with this eventually. I just want to at least give them a quick shout out because I feel terrible for still not even having done anything with it. I quite like this thing. This video is not sponsored, by the way. I just wanted to mention this because they, you know, sent this to me after I asked them if I can borrow it, and they just said, keep it, it's fine. So I very much appreciate that. And it's quite well made. So if you have something like this, of course, yeah, reach is not an issue. Power is not an issue at all. You can strike hard with this, and because you have two hands on it, it's also more maneuverable. This, of course, is way lighter than a steel mace would be, but you definitely generally have a lot more control over it with two hands compared to one. So this would be difficult to defend against. This would be better to defend with. So you always have to keep that in mind. Two-handed versions generally score a little better, so to speak, in a lot of regards. So the next con is that you don't have a very effective attack available, or only to a limited degree, and that is thrusts. Now, with something like this, you can do it. There are thrusts with quarter staves in the historical manuscripts, and that can do some damage. You know, if you imagine thrusting to the face with something like this, the steel version obviously, yeah, that would not be good times. And some have spikes like this, so yeah, you can absolutely thrust with the spike on this hammer. It's just not going to be as effective as a sword thrust because this is all you can work with. So imagine the opponent is wearing a gambeson, or let's say a gambeson with mail on top, or even plate, you probably have about this much material to get through just in terms of bulk. So that limits half of it. Of course, swords is where it's at for thrusts. And finally, they can be gripped more easily by the opponent. I'm not saying somebody could just snatch it out of the air. Like, you strike at them, they just go, nope. That's not going to happen because you're going to shatter their hand and their wrist, etc. But if there's a situation where you come to a bind, again, it's not as likely with blunt weapons because they would just blow through instead of just being stopped and binding the way swords do. But if there's some kind of situation, like let's say you miss and you come around and the opponent moves in and manages to grab this before you've accelerated fully. So they've intercepted it, they've grabbed it, now they have a really good hold on your weapon, they can wrench it around, they can try to disarm you. Now, against swords, there are techniques like this in the manuscripts, where somebody actually grabs a sword and, you know, controls it. So it can be done, but there is also mention of the response in the manuscripts, you know, like wrenching it out of the hand and slicing the hand as you draw the sword out. So if they don't have a perfect grip on it, especially if, you know, the hand is sweaty or slippery or whatever, then this, of course, is not a great idea to grip a sword. That's a lot easier with this. Even more so if they grip it here, because now there's even something preventing the palm from slipping, so now they have plenty of control, and this is at the end of a lever, so they can manipulate that a lot more easily. And then I've got two points that are kind of in between. They're neither pro or con, or can be both. For example, blunt weapons can be either somewhat fragile or indestructible, basically. If you look at this club, for example, that I've tested, it's pretty slim. And it's just wood. So if a blade were to cut into it a couple of times, it would break very easily. And some other designs are just not quite as strong. Like if you were to parry with the haft of an early medieval mace, for example, wooden haft, it wouldn't survive as long. It's the same disadvantage as with axes and spears, unless they are reinforced, you know, like in this case, there's steel langets, so you can absolutely defend with this and it's going to be fine. So it depends on what it is. If a sword and a hammer collide like this, you know, if you manage to strike the blade, let alone on the edge, this is going to be wrecked. Or even with the langets, you know, if the sword cuts in, the sword is going to take a lot more damage than this. That's it for now. I've probably forgotten some points. In fact, I know that was in the middle of talking earlier when I talked about the pros, I was thinking, oh yeah, yeah, there's this other con that I should also mention later, and now it's gone. I don't know what the hell it was.
Your wrist all right?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Feel free to discuss in the comments what do you think are the pros and cons. Other than that, I hope you found it interesting, entertaining, educational perhaps, and thanks for watching. Have a good one, folks.